But I thought maybe the fire ants had eaten the trailer, just to be honest with you. But everything eats here. But anyway, let's worship the Lord today. Amen. Let's thank Him for how good He is. Thank Him for all the goodness that He's shown us. And praise Him today. Brother, come on, let's sing.
I wanted to tell everyone that I had told our Sunday school class. And I woke up this morning at 4 o'clock, and I texted Brother Jim shortly after that. I knew he would be up, but I realized that this Sunday today is the 6 months since the first Sunday I spent here at Fannin Road and became a member of this church. And amen, I love this church, and I thank each and every one of you for your prayers, because I know without your prayers, I wouldn't be here today. And it's 6 months. I can't believe how fast time has gone. Let's turn to this song here and stand, and we're going to sing two verses of it and have our welcome of each other. And like I said, remember to tell each other you love them. 56, the old rugged cross. If y'all know of one any better, let me know right now or forevermore hold your peace. 56, please stand, please.
Cherish the
turn your hymn books to, I was going to sing this, and I don't think I can, y'all. My voice is really messed up this morning. Not that it's great, but it's really bad. But I think we ought to sing this one. 361, Heavenly Sunlight. I am barely able to talk, whether y'all realize it or not. But I'm going to do the best I can with no excuses. I said when I got out of the hospital, I'd have no more excuses. So y'all bear with me, please. 361. And then the ushers come forward at the last verse. We're going to sing probably two verses of this. First and last verse. Walking in sunlight, all of my journey over the mountain, through the deep end. Would you lead us in prayer, please?
Our dear Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us be in your house today, Lord. Let the message be strong and the Holy Spirit move in our church
Amen.
Today, Lord. Bless this offering we take up in your name, Jesus Christ, we pray.
Amen.
Do you have a color preference, Randy? Okay, red it is. Red is nice. Keep walking, but you just don't see how.
This trial won't define you. It will only refine you. You know there's a plan, though you don't see it now. Your God will not forget you. He'll eventually direct you. And don't be afraid, because you can know. Your heart may be wounded, all your plans adjusted, your faith may be tested, but God can be trusted. When your life's a question mark, and all your answers are coming out wrong, you know that God is working, but it just seems so long. Don't give up on God when he's working on you. It's Jesus the Son that he's forming in you. This trial
In a world that you really and truly, you don't know what, when people tell you something today, whether it's going to happen or not. But you know what? The Lord doesn't change. He's always trustworthy. You can always trust him. And I appreciate that song there, young lady. I know we need to pray. I just found out just a little while ago, Andrew Dura was in an accident yesterday. Is that correct? And he's not feeling well right now, so definitely pray for Andrew also. I guess brakes didn't work right on the car or something along that line. And I guess stopping was a problem, and that didn't work, so something else happened. Amen. Run into someone, evidently. Nobody was seriously hurt, though, correct? Good, good. Just a car. Car's not doing well. Cars are replaceable, amen? People are not. And but anyway, I know Charette was supposed to have junior church. You got it? Okay. All right. What?
Sixth grade.
You want to take them? You sure?
Yes, sir.
All right, sixth grade and below, out that door. I can't hear you. Yeah, if you want to check out a tape from the ladies' seminar, my wife bought those, and they're available to you. It'd be good to watch them. They're very good there. I know you'd enjoy that. Bye, young lady. Bye, May.
Bye.
All right. Amen. Open your Bibles up. Right, you know, we do have a lot going on, and looking forward to baptizing a young man here in just a few minutes. And look to Zechariah. You know, if you don't know where that's at, go to Matthew, and then go back into the Old Testament, and you'll pass Malachi, and then you'll find Zechariah. Not a book that's preached out of a whole lot, but I'm going to this morning, the book of Zechariah. It's okay to take your coat off, take your shoes off. Just don't take nothing else off, amen? And that'll stick with some of y'all in just a few minutes. But the book of Zechariah, in Zechariah, look in chapter number 3. Zechariah, chapter number 3. If you found your place, come on in there. AT&T's in the house, amen? All righty. Zechariah chapter 3. Let's all stand. We're gonna read a few verses out of Zechariah. I'll give you a little bit of context in what Zechariah is about, and then we're going to look at something that I think all of us will be able to identify with this morning. Zechariah chapter 3, and he showed, verse number 1, and he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and notice this, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. That's normal. And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that has chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? That's basically a brand is a burning stick. He pulled it up out of the fire, the nation of Israel there. He's talking about there, about Jerusalem there. Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and will clothe thee, notice here's my text, and will clothe thee with what? A change of what? Of raiment, a change of clothes. He's going to clothe him differently. And I said, let them set a fair mitre upon his head. That's a band around his head. So set a fair mitre upon his head and clothed him with the garments. And the angel of the Lord stood by him. Let's pray. Father, this morning I'm thankful, Lord, to be in your house. God, I know we can trust you today in a world that seems to be topsy-turvy and upside down. And Lord, we can go to you today and know that we have a hope that's built on nothing less but Jesus' blood and his righteousness this morning. Thank you, Lord, already for the special music. Thank you, Lord, for sending, Lord, folks out to church on this day. I pray, Lord, now you'll bless this message in spite of this pastor. And we love you and praise you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Y'all be seated for just a few moments. I'll try to get us done here as quickly as I can, but I want the Holy Spirit to move. You know, you talk about context. What is Zechariah about? Well, there's a lot of symbolism in Zechariah. You've got to understand this book. It's much about what will happen one day in the kingdom age. One day, very soon, I believe, the Lord's going to come back. Let me just give you a synopsis here. And one day, the Lord's coming back. Amen? And the trumpet's going to sound, and the dead in Christ are going to rise, and then we which will remain shall be caught up together. And that will begin a seven-year period known as the tribulation period. I've heard about it my entire life. I've studied about it my entire life. That's coming one day. But after the tribulation period, there'll be a period known as the millennium. That's a thousand-year reign when Jesus will come and rule and reign. Now, this is a lot to do in chapter 3 about that period for the Jew. See, Joshua is a high priest. He represents the priesthood here. He also represents the people of Israel. And by the way, the nation of Israel is wayward. They're dirty in the sight of God. Now, don't misunderstand me. They're still God's chosen people. Don't ever forget that. Some people try to tell you that they're no longer, but you better think now. They're God's chosen people. They're wayward. They're away from the Lord. But God is going to clean them up one day. He's going to make them a vessel under honor. Amen. And even though they're not there right now, but it appears that Joshua, he's dressed in dirty garments. Things are not right. God is promising that I'm going to change those dirty garments to something that's going to be appropriate. That will happen in the millennium. But for us this morning, I want to say to, for us, for this passage to make sense to us, look in that verse I mentioned a moment ago, I will clothe thee with a change of raiment. The old saying goes like this. Y'all can fill in the blank. The clothes make the man. You ever heard that? Clothes is big in our day and time. Did y'all know that? I mean, I like to wear them. I mean, I don't. Somebody asks me all the time, preacher, what do I need to wear to church? Clothes. Just put clothes on, amen. If you come naked, it's going to mess up the whole service. I can guarantee that. But you know, the idea here is it says a lot about what you wear. You know, sometimes Deborah will. This morning especially, she's back in the back evidently. But this morning, I went in there to pick out a suit of clothes to wear, and I make up my mind what I'm going to wear in about 15 seconds. I look at it and I just reach up and grab it. You'll get right down to it. I really don't care. I would wear the same suit every Sunday as far as I'm concerned. And the only reason I wear this is because I don't think you put a coat on. By the way, this coat got wool in it. The only time you ought to wear something like this is in cold weather, to be honest with you. But I put this on, but I go up there. Anyway, I'm in there in the bedroom. I got my coat laid out on the bed there. And here she comes in the corner. I see her come to the side there and look at me. And then she heads back because, she's got her closet in our bedroom. And then in the spare room, she's got her closet, amen. And then in my room where my closet is supposed to be, she's got her closet there. So she went back to get her clothes out of all those places, and I see her coming, and she comes in there with her suit, a suit coat, and it looks like mine. I said, "We're going to be twins today." She said, "Yeah, I saw that." See, that's unimportant to me. I could care less. What color suit she wears. Well, I mean, I do want her to look nice. Don't misunderstand me that. But clothes is not big to me. Just wear them. That's the only thing I ask. But clothes in our society is a big deal. Y'all remember years ago? It's been 15 years ago. 2005, by the way. They have a thing every year. It's called the best dress. You remember that? Who's the best dress? Well, in 2005, a gal by the name of Catherine Zeta-Jones was the best dressed in Hollywood. And the best dressed man was Matt Lauer. By the way, he's kind of bad now, amen? He's out the window through the woods to grandma's house because he's done. And then at the Senate, the best dressed person there was a woman by the name of Hillary Rotten. Rotten Clinton. Amen. Yeah. I don't know whether she's rotten or not. Rotten. I pronounced that right. I don't know anything about it. I stay away. Yeah, I might have got it right the first time, to be honest with you. I think most of these politicians fit that word, just to be truthful with you. I'm not big into politics, but you know the problem we got today is people, we look on the outward appearance. Amen. We look at what's on the outside, and we know in 1 Samuel chapter 16, when they were looking for a king, God said, you look on the outward, but I look on the inward. In chapter 16 of 1 Samuel says that. But this morning, just for a few minutes, I want you to think about three garments. And I'm going to look at each one of these for a few moments, but I'd ask you this morning to look at your life, examine yourself. You know, nobody else can examine your heart. You know that, don't you? You ever had somebody tell you, you don't know what my heart is? You ever had somebody judge you? By the way, people judge you no matter what. They're going to judge you today. Just get over that and don't worry about it. One lady come to me one day and said to me, "Why are you bald-headed?" I looked at her and I said, "Because I like my hair cut like this, amen." I cut my hair like this. That's a stupid question. I'm bald-headed because my daddy was bald-headed, just to be honest with you, and probably his daddy was bald-headed. But there's three garments that I want to give you for a few minutes, and I want you to examine which one you are wearing today, because you are wearing one today. The first garment, I brought something with me this morning. I like show and tell. Some of y'all went to school, but some of y'all, this right here is my work hat. Amen. This right here is the shirt that I wear in the garden, on the tractor, anything else. I put this bad boy on. Now my wife would have a fit seeing me do this, but I don't care because she's back in the nursery. This is what I wear when I go to pick beans, when I go down there to pick peas. This is what I put on. This is my work clothes. Amen. If you see me down in the garden, I'm going to have a tie on and all that too. Amen. I'm going to look just like this. I'm going to have a pair of blue jeans on. I'm going to have my brogans on. And by the way, this thing, you say, did this thing get washed? Yeah, it's clean. But this is what it looks like. It's got stuff all over it. But the first one is this one. This is a garment, listen, that's stained by sin. Did you hear what I said? This verse, look with me in verse number 3. Chapter number 3, verse number 3. Now, Joshua was clothed with filth filthy garments and he stood before the angel. This is a picture, whether you want to face this or not. See, right now we're all standing before God. Did you know that? Some of us are clothed with a garment that is the garment, I will call it, of sin. When God sees you today, he sees this garment of sin. It's a picture of every single person that has ever lived. The Bible tells us in a lot of different places that we're all what? We're all sinners. By the way, you can read Isaiah 64. I like this hat. Now, can I tell you what happened to it? I know this is a rabbit trail. You ever been to church or preaching this on rabbit trails? That means the message is going to be long. You see right there? I was bush hogging one day, and I was on that, and the wind blew it off, and I run over it with the bush hog. And I wasn't happy, but you know what I did? I put it right back on, because it fits my bald head, amen? And I put it right back on my head, but I want to give you information, because you thought, I got a whole box full of hats. But I like this one. Amen. So I wear this one. But my point is this. In Isaiah 64, it says that our this old flesh is like a filthy rag. It pretty much, in that old rag it's talking about is a rag that they used to tie around the lepers that had the... They had disease, and they would wrap those rags around them. They were full of pus. God sees us. He sees us as that rag. We're wrapped up in this world. We look like the world. We act like the world. And let's just be honest with you. I grew up on a farm. We're like a hog. You know, you probably never washed a hog. Most of you never have. Most of you have eaten a few hogs, as I can tell. But a hog, you can wash him up. You can clean him up. You can put a bow on a hog. But I'm going to tell you something about a hog. Just as soon as he gets the opportunity, he's going to the mud hole. He's going to go waller. He's going to get in that mess. He's going to like it. Well, I got news for us. You may come in here and think you are somebody, like my preacher preached last week, but I got news for you. All of us are sinners. All of us. I don't care who you are. You put your drawers on just like I do. You walk around with your pious little nose stuck up in there thinking I'm a somebody. I got news for you. You're a sinner just like I am. And by the way, it's easy for me to understand. I never had any problem realizing I was a sinner. Anthony, I mean, I knew that. That was something that I was good at doing. I wasn't good at a lot of things, but sinning was something that I found that I could accomplish. It's a hard truth. When God sees us, he sees us unfit. He looks at us, and he sees us. Because see, God, here's something you don't hear in church anymore. God is holy. Somebody says, God is the old man upstairs. First of all, he's not an old man. Second of all, he is a holy God. And you know what? I grew up, I'll take my hat off there. I grew up in church. I grew up in church, and I grew up in church where they taught the Bible at some level, but I never got saved till I was much older, 21 years old before I accepted the Lord. But this thing of being a sinner is not something people want to hear today. Whether we need to face it or not face it, we should. We cannot approach God with this mess. We can't do that. You know, people want to today. They don't care. They say this, it don't matter what you do. It don't matter what you believe, because we're just all going to heaven. I got some bad news for you. That's not in here. The Bible says that the one way is wide, the gate is wide, and then it said one gate is very narrow. You know which one is very narrow? That's the way of salvation. That's the truth of what God's Word said. It is a narrow way, but wide is the gate, the Bible says in Matthew, that leads to what? Destruction. But your little narrow gate over here, the church today is composed of a lot of people. You can go down here to some of the largest churches in Montgomery, Alabama, and you can walk in there and say, listen, tell me something. If you die today, do you know where you're going? The average church member will say, well, I don't think you can know that. I'm not sure. Or they say, I'm fixing to baptize a young man back here. And they say, well, I was confirmed in my church, and I was dipped in water or sprinkled by some water. None of that's going to do you any good one day, because it will not. You know, the old song says, what can wash away my sin? And the answer to that is, nothing but the blood of Jesus. That water will not do it. You know, we get so caught up today, we all have sinned and come short. I'll give you something to think on. When you think about sin, we are victims to it because our daddies was a sinner, and his daddy was a sinner, and his daddy was a sinner, and track it all the way back to a man by the name of Adam. Adam gets a bad rap. Amen? Adam and Eve both. Somebody said, well, if Adam hadn't done this and Adam done that, can I news for you? If Adam's name had been Jim, I'd have failed. Because I was, God made us this way. Yes, He did. He allowed us to be able to sin. He allowed us to choose. See, God, if He didn't, then we'd be nothing but robots that God has made, and God wants us to choose right and not wrong. And that is the truth. But there's not a person that's ever been born into this world. You know, whether it's little Catherine, you know, she come down through here, and all my kids, all my granddaughters are beautiful. Amen. She come down through here. They look like they're grandma. Come down through here, just coming down through. Can I tell you something about her? As precious as she is, and her mom and daddy's right back there, they'll tell you she knows what sin is already. She can. I will guarantee they'll tell you. You know what? Because now, yeah, I guarantee she's already done something where they had to pop her hands and say, "No, don't do that." Whatever happened to be? Why? You don't have to teach people to do wrong. It's in our DNA. But realize this: what in the world does sin do to us? Ephesians chapter 2 tells us that it makes us spiritually dead. In Isaiah 59, it tells us that we're separated from God. Do you realize in Psalm 66:18, it says, if I regard iniquity, that's the word for sin, in my heart, then God won't even hear us. Do you realize in Proverbs 13, it tells us that sin will bring misery? How many of y'all have ever experienced that, where what you did cost you something? Amen? Boy, it's cost me. I'll be honest with you right now. It still cost you. Can I tell you one more thing? There's something we know. Psalms 9, verse 17 tells us that if that sin is not paid for correctly, then you will pay for it. And it'll be paid for in a place that's called hell. And I don't. How many wants to raise their hand and wants to go there? I asked one day, how many wants to go to hell? You know, and somebody actually raised their hand. That's either a crazy person or a fool, because nobody. One of the things I don't like is fire. You know, water don't bother me, but fire, I have a fear of fire. I don't want to be in no fire. I don't want to get burnt. I mentioned this before. You used to have, you and I the same age. Back, you remember when you used to play chicken with a cigarette? You remember that? You lay your arms down there, and they drop that cigarette in between your arms. And in verse 1, it moved with chicken. Amen? Now, I'm going to tell you something. I did that a few times, but I found out something. That thing would burn, and that thing puts marks on your hand, arms in there. What a stupid thing to do, drop a lit cigarette down between your arms and see who moves first. Well, I got news for you. I moved first, because I found out it H-U-R-T. Amen? It hurts, and sin will do that, but, you know, it'll cause every single person. Over in Matthew chapter 7, it says Jesus one day will look at you, and he'll say, I never knew you. Can't you imagine one day people are going to say, no, I went to First Church. I went to First Baptist Church. I went to this church. I went to that church. You can go to every church in Montgomery, Alabama, Elmore County, Autauga County. You can go to church everywhere in Alabama and still die and go to hell. Did you know that? Because walking in that door don't make you a Christian no more than walking in a garage makes you a car. Amen. It don't work that way. You've got to know Him personally. You've got to accept Him. He doesn't make you like a robot. He doesn't force you to do anything. He comes to you and speaks to you. I want to say this morning before I move to my second clothes that I'm going to wear for you. This one here is one that's got sin. If you're here this morning and the clothes you have on right now is sin, and God sees this sin. I'll make sense in just a moment. And God sees this sin, and He doesn't see something else, then you're in trouble. You're in serious trouble. Because if you leave this world today, there's something waiting for you that wasn't prepared for you. It was prepared for the devil and his angels. I don't want you to go there. Somebody says, well, preacher, somebody asked me one day, I guess you want them hellfire and damnation preachers. And I said, well, let me ask you a question. I said, number one, before I get too far, I said, is there a hell? And they said, yeah, I think so. I said, then people that go there, would they be damned? And they said, well, yeah, I guess so. And I said, well, then I'm a hellfire and damnation preacher. I'm going to preach that is a real place. Amen. And people will go there. Yeah. I don't like that. I don't like the fact of the matter is, but this Bible says that there is, and I trust this book a whole lot more than I do somebody, because this is God's word on it. Right. Somebody said that Jesus preached more about hell than he did about heaven. Well, I'll tell you one thing. He told a story about a rich man and Lazarus. You remember that one?
Right.
He told a story about hell and about what it was like. And if that don't cause you to have a fear, then my dear friend, probably you need to get it today. I don't want you to leave here today lost. Now, the second garment's a little bit different. Look with me in verse number 4, if you will. I put this on. Look at verse number 4. The first one is the garment of sin. The second one, it says, and he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away, now notice this, take away the filthy garment from him. Took it off. And unto him he said, Behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee. I will clothe thee with a change of raiment. Now, the next one is a little bit different. I got to do one more thing before I do this. This will make more sense to you in just a second. Shouldn't took this off yet. Got ahead of myself. This right here is a Pierre Cardin. Amen. A big word for something. Now, this is the garment of what? Okay, looks pretty good. Got it on. Now, the next one, though, is a little bit different. You got this one on, and he says he took the garment. Now, I'm going to leave it on just for an illustration. Here is the garment I'm going to call self-righteousness. You put this one on. Now, this is a nice Joseph Banks suit. Put that thing on. All right. Now, that filthy garment, you know, he removed, he said, from the garment, and praise the Lord for that. But here's a problem. If this thing is not properly removed like it's supposed to be, and we're going to get in this just a second, there's only one way to get rid of that first one. You know that, don't you? But here's what we do. We put on something called my self-righteousness. We get us a suit on to cover it up. We make ourselves look good. We cover ourselves up, and we make the world think, you know, I'm a somebody. Well, Brother Farr done told us that we ain't, amen? And I agree with him on that. We're not. But you put on this suit, and you know, I have run into some of the most wicked people in my life that were self-righteous. People that think, you know what, look at me. You know, I never cared for people that got their nose up in the air, amen? That's the folks, I'll be honest with you, I don't have the time of day for. They walk around like they're somebody, and they're somebody, they don't, you know, they act like that. Well, I found out a long time ago, every single one of us here, outside the grace of God, we're nobody. Outside of what God can do for us. But our world is filled with people. And what you're trying to do is, see, the only one who can remove this filthy stain right here is who? Is the Lord Jesus Christ. But what we try to do is, we try to remove it ourselves, Brother Ricky. We try to get rid of it ourselves. We try to cover it up. We try to make it look like, every single one of us have got things in our lives that we ain't happy with. Amen? Every single one of us have got sins in our lives, I promise you this morning, that we ain't happy with. But what we do is, we take that, and you know, how many of y'all remember the story of the Garden of Eden? Do you remember when Adam and Eve sinned? They found out that they were naked. Amen. They didn't even know they were naked. That's kind of hard to fathom, ain't it? But what did they do to cover up what they were going to do? What did they do? Someone tell me. They took fig leaves and sewed them together. They tried to make a covering for themselves to cover up their own sin. See, they had to do it themselves. Now, y'all know that, and I know I'm ahead of myself, but you know God's going to fix that problem, and, you know, he's going to fix that because he made them a garment, amen, that wasn't made out of fig leaves, amen? And you know that was a blood sacrifice. That right, the blood sacrifice is what took care of it, and that blood sacrifice was Jesus Christ for you and I today. But the problem of this self-righteousness is we try to make our own garments. We try to make our own way. We're going to say, well, here's a word for it. Many people today come to church. I love y'all for being here. They get religion. They start going to church. Here's one. They start self-improvement. You ever heard that word? Or here's one. First of the year, we call it turning over a new leaf. Amen? I'm going to do this. You know, they'll stop drinking. They'll stop cussing. They'll stop running around on their wife or their husband. And they will give up all this stuff that they say is wrong. In other words, they try some way to make a garment themselves to make it so they're okay with God. But the problem, no matter what you want to think this morning, is this. The problem is on the inside.
Oh, yeah.
And man can never fix the inside. See, I can cover this up. Matter of fact, you know, it would look stupid, but I could cover this up right now with this coat, and you wouldn't know that I got a piece of junk shirt on up under here, would you? Makes us look good. Well, the truth of the matter is that, you know, we're all sinners. But the self-righteous person is just a little bit harder to deal with because this person thinks that they're okay with God. If a man's got cancer, goes to the doctor, and the doctor says, you've got cancer, and the only way to take care of this is to go in there and remove the tumor. And he says, nope. Right now, this cancer is causing me to have these problems. We call them symptoms. So we just take some pain meds, or we take something to help this. Those are all treatment of the symptom, but the actual problem is a tumor. Amen? You got the cancer. You got it in your body. We try to fix our inside with just symptoms. You know, I'm glad y'all come to church. I'm glad y'all come, but I'm going to tell you something. It ain't going to get you to heaven. And you should come. This is God. This is the Lord's day. You ought to be here today.
Right.
You ought to be here tonight. You ought to be here on Wednesday nights. But today, man tries to make things look better because he wants to be self. Notice this next word, righteous. Give it to you like this. He wants to be right with God, but he wants to do it himself.
Amen.
That's a hard thing to do because it is impossible. There's only one remedy for sin. And we're going to look at that when I baptize Brother Larry in just a few minutes. But in Acts 16, old boy says, what can I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ with all thine heart. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Amen? Nothing but that. There's no other answer. You know, if you've been trying to be a good person, please listen to this. Get a hold of this. You say, well, you know what? I'm trying to do my fellow man right. You're trying. But it's impossible for man to ever do that. Should you do good? Should you do right? Sure you should. But I'm going to tell you now, you're going to fail. You're going to fail, Chucky. Did you know that? You're going to fail, man. You're going to fail. How long y'all been married now?
3 weeks Saturday.
Has he failed in any way in the last 3 weeks? Go ahead and say yes. Go ahead and say yes. I already know the answer to that. You don't have to lie. Don't make him. Has he already? Yes, he has, because he's a sinner. And Chucky, I won't ask you the same question. Has she failed? Absolutely. She burnt the biscuits, didn't she, brother? Yes.
Not this morning.
Not this morning. Amen. Good. Good to hear. If you're trying to be a good person, hold your place in Zechariah. Turn to 1 John with me. 1 John, not Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but the end there. 1 John, look with me in 1 John chapter number 2 and verse number 2. If you're trying to get there, Jesus has already taken care of this for you. 1 John chapter 2, verse number 2. The scripture says, and he is a propitiation. Very big word. That means the satisfaction and the appeasement. He's the propitiation for our what? Sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Do you realize that when Jesus died on the cross, he paid for all of our sins, all of them? That's a neat thing, amen? That just amazes me that he would do that. Y'all, there's some folks in here, I mean, I've known Claudette Reddick now for 20 plus years, and I think the world of her, and if not a whole lot I wouldn't do for Claudette Reddick. But you know what? Truth of the matter is, Claudette's a sinner too.
Yep.
She's a sinner too. But you see, Jesus still loved us regardless of who we were. He loved every single one of us and cares about us. And we try to clean ourselves up. You know, people don't realize this, but there's absolutely no difference between a guy that says he's an atheist and the guy that's got some kind of religion he's trusting in. You know, you take a guy that's a serial killer, he's no worse than the guy sitting on the pew of most churches today.
That's right.
Because we're all sinners. It's hard to understand. You see, religion is us trying to reach God, and God's reached down to us. Some of you become members of our church. You join the church. I'm going to baptize Larry in just a few minutes. Larry, I'll tell you now, that water will not wash away your sins. You know, but people think that it does. That water won't even wash the dirt off you real good, just to be honest with you, in Montgomery. But I'll tell you this much. When you asked the Lord to save you the other day at this revival service right here,
right,
Jesus took care of your sins.
Amen.
The problem was, he had died for you 2,000 years ago, but you acknowledged that today. You acknowledged that it didn't cost you a penny, but it cost the Lord everything. Everything. If you've been trying to be a good person, let me just help you right now. I want you to do good. But you better quit trying to do it to appease God and make yourself righteous, because it won't work. The first one was the garment of sin. The second one is a garment that says, I'm self-righteous and I'm right with God. The third one is the best one, the one I like. The third one, look with me if you will, put my coat back on. I come in this morning, I turn the heat on. turned the heat on this morning. None of y'all were here. Turned the heat on. It was about 65 in here, a little bit damp. Turned it on about 70. I come back in here. Brother Rick had showed up. Turned it down to 65 or something. Another man. He had frost hanging on the walls. But I put my coat back on. But the third one is this one. Look in verse number 4 with me. Go back to Zechariah. This drop down and take away. Notice this. It says, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, Behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee. Notice that. I will clothe thee with a change of raiment, a change of clothes. And I said, in verse 5, let them set a fair mitre, that's a band upon his head. So they set a fair mitre upon his head and clothed him with garments, and the angel of the Lord stood by. The third one is the garment, folks, listen, of salvation. He had on a garment right here. He come to him with this old dirty shirt, sin. But when God comes along, he takes away that sin.
Right.
Throw it over there, and he puts on him a different garment now.
Amen.
Brand new garment.
Yep.
It's called salvation. Now, I'll tell you something. You can't see it. You can't see it, but I'll guarantee you, if you've got it, you know it. And I'll tell you something else. If you've got it, the world will know it. But the world is so quiet today. People get saved today, and we had 10 folks. We had Youngin saved, Brother Larry saved. We had people get saved, they come to Christ, and you never see them again. You never hear from them again. And when you see them, they're just like they were. Let me help you with this. If they're not a changed person, they never got it. All they got was a little commitment that they made, a feel-bad message. The message, you know, I can get up here and preach a message and make you feel bad. That's not why I'm here. I want you to walk away from here today. If you're here today and you're lost, I want you to go walk away from here saved. But the verse tells us the Lord took away Joshua's dirty, filthy garments. That's what the Lord did for me, and that's what the Lord did for you. Amen? When a sinner comes to the Lord,
hallelujah.
It's great. You know what the Bible describes it in John chapter 3, verse 3 and verse 7 as the new birth. Second of all, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, you're a new creature. And in Colossians 3:10, you're a new man. Larry, how old are you?
Seven.
I had you at 68, man. Did you know that, Rich? Rick, I thought he was just 68, man. He's 2 years older than I thought he was.
Count the mileage, I'll probably be about
100. Count the mileage. But you know, when the Lord saved you just a few days ago, he gave you a brand new garment. Man, you're a different man. Now, do you still have to deal right now? The sin is paid for. The problem is, we got a lot of stuff in this old world we want to hang on to. Amen? And we want to hang on to it. And we try to hang on to all the stuff that the devil has piled on us. Most of the sins that I had problems with, I picked them up as a teenager. Most of the stuff I learned that I shouldn't do, I picked them up when I was young. You know why the devil works with our young people? Because he knows if he can get you hooked, he can keep you for your lifetime. Drugs, alcohol, you name what it happens to be, most of us get involved with it when we're young, and it's difficult. You know, up in... slap out, Hopeful, for you folks who are not from here, Hopeful, Alabama. Young man the other night was up there. You probably heard the story on the news. If you didn't, awful story. Young man was out there. They had been drinking. And I understand that the one young man was talking to his girlfriend, and the other guy got mad about it and just walked up there. The old term used to be cold cocked. Have you ever heard that now? Just haul back and hit the guy upside the head with his fist. The last word I heard that young man is at Baptist on a ventilator, expected to die. How? Can I tell you how? Sin.
Yeah.
Anger. This prisons are full of people that got angry one time. They get angry at something, and they get mad about something, and they do something, they go, and then later on they wonder why. We all have fell into that pot, amen?
Yes,
every one of us has. But you know something? In one thing, and I'm almost done. Do you know there's only one requirement to go to heaven? One requirement. One requirement. Do anyone know what it is? Well, okay, yeah, I got that, but one requirement before you can step in. That's there too. Perfection.
He can't.
Whoa, hang in there. Don't go nowhere. Don't jump on me yet. I knew you was going to. I wanted to hook it. Now I got the hook in you. Let me pull, get that bass. Perfection. No one will walk into heaven with sin. You can't get there. God does not look upon sin. You have to have perfection. You say, preacher, you better explain. You're not going to ever be perfect. These three young men coming in here, they're leaving junior church because of that very reason. Them three ain't never going to be perfect. I know that already. I understand that. They're never going to be perfect. Now, let me give you a verse. See, God, when Jesus died on the cross, get this. He died to pay for all of your sins, every one of them.
Yes.
And when you take away your sins, get this, guess what you are? You're perfect. When he takes away your sins, you're perfect. Okay, you say, well, preacher, I'm going to sin in about 30 minutes. Well, you're probably going to sin before then. But they're already paid for. They were bought on the cross. Let me give you a verse so you say, well, he's throwing this at me now. Look at, turn to Romans. Just go there for a second. Romans, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts, 1st, 2nd Corinthians. Don't go that far. Go to Romans, right after Acts. Romans chapter 5. Let me show you this verse, and I'll be done. Romans chapter 5 and verse number 1. Show you one word. Romans 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our who?
Lord.
Our Lord Jesus Christ. That word justify, I love this expression, just if I had never sinned. Justified. You become justified. That means in His eyes, when God sees us. Now, let me ask y'all a question. Is your pastor a sinner?
Yeah.
Now, this whole thing right here, is my sin dirty? But I got news for you. When God sees this old preacher, He doesn't see my sin any longer. What does He see? He sees the blood of Jesus, His Son. And you remember, I told you a minute ago, we read, the devil was standing there beside of the priest. And he was doing what? He's the accuser. He was doing what? He was standing there saying, hey, look at him. Look at that sorry dog. That's the devil for you. Devil's like, what's in the baseball game when they walk up to the plate and throw the dirt on it? You ever seen them do that mess? I ain't never. Why do they do that anyway? I don't know anything about baseball. What's the whole purpose? You know, they throw dirt on the plate. They want to get somebody mad. The devil's up there. He's up in heaven, and he's down here right now. He's looking down there, and he sees an old bald-headed preacher, and he's saying, that guy is a sorry individual. And Jesus says, yeah, but I paid for him. I bought and paid for him. My blood was shed on the cross for him. Well, he cusses. He shouldn't. But I paid for him. He gets drunk. Oh, man, Christians can't drink, can they? Just margaritas. Just margaritas. They're not bad. That's a lie. The devil can make it taste good, but he still has the same problem. Think about this a second. How in the world, y'all were hitting on a minute ago, we have to be perfect. Now, how can we get perfect before God? Used to be an old track, and it was called the ABCs of salvation. All have sinned, amen? A fact, you got to admit that you are a sinner. And you've got to acknowledge that my only way to take care of this is that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. And believe what He did. And then second, the B means believe. Amen? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and trust in Him. And C, the C stands for confession. Someone says, what should I do? Confess Him. God, save me. I believe You died on the cross for my sins. Lord, save me today. You know, it's not an automatic thing. You have to ask Him to save you. Jesus will not just automatically do that. He will let you, but He'll give you the opportunity. Just a few days ago, standing right out there at the old brush arbor, man, you write that date down in your Bible. You record that in your Bible, because Larry, I'm going to tell you what the devil's going to do.
Yep.
First time you fail, because I know, because it happens to me. I do something, my wife will say, ain't you the preacher? I'm going, shut up, woman. She's back in the back. But the devil will do this. The devil will come along and he'll say, Lester, you're a sorry individual. He does me that way. And I'm thinking, gosh. And then the Lord will say, but Jim, I died for you. I shed my blood for you.
Right.
You know what it does for me? It takes me to my knees to realize that God will forgive me. And I get on my knees and say, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for popping him in the head. I didn't mean to do that. I'm sorry, Lord. Forgive me. And you know what he does every time? 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sin, you'd write that verse down, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us of all of our unrighteousness. Because the only way we can be right with God
right.
is to get those sins taken care of. But when we're not right with him as a believer, we still got to go to him because we got a fellowship problem then. The goody ain't there no more. Sometimes you come into church and you just say, you know, my shout ain't there no more. I don't want to put my hand up in the air anymore. I don't want to praise the Lord anymore. That's because of sin. We allow that stuff to come back and attack us and hit us. And the old garments that we've had there, the old sinner, you know, those garments were taken care of. You know, I looked this up and it didn't mean anything to me, but the best dressed person in the world wears a Vanquish II suit made by Dormula. I don't know how to pronounce that, but that suit sells for $95,000. That's $1,000. The best dressed lady, the cheapest dress that the couture, Dior couture makes, the cheapest one they make sells for $20,000, and it goes up to almost $300,000 for the wedding in that group. But can I tell you, listen, boy, this will cause you to get excited. Do you know that if you're saved today, you got the garment of salvation on.
Right.
You got something worth a whole lot more than $300,000. Because we're going to go to a place called heaven one day, and the streets are gold up there, and we're going to walk down, and we're going to go, wow, look at this. This is my wedding band. Wow. Wow. That's gold. I mean, this thing back in 1977, it cost me $60. Should have bought some gold back then. $60. The gold is the whole streets is like that. And the only way you can get there is you've got to have the garment of salvation. But today, you go to church in and out, and nobody will ever take. Oh, I just hope that you're going to go to heaven. Larry Jordan's going to go to heaven because he had some friends that believe that.
Amen.
He had some folks that were concerned about him. I know that. But I'm going to tell you, the best friends in the world are the ones that tell you the truth.
Amen.
I tell folks, I use this expression, I stole it years ago, sometimes you have to tell people the baby's ugly. Sometimes you have to tell them that baby's ugly. And if you look at a friend and you love them and you say, listen, I don't want you to go to hell, but if you don't get saved, you're going there. We don't do it because we're afraid we'll offend somebody. You let some of your friends die and go to hell one day. I believe that in Hebrews it talks about there's a great group of people that are able. Could you imagine being able to be in heaven? And to be able, come back out here, to be able to be up in heaven. You're up here, and you're able to look, and down in a place called hell, you look down there, and you see that person that lived beside of you, that brother, that cousin, that friend, who happened to be, and you're there. Great cloud of witnesses. Is that true? I don't know, but it would surely be heartful to think that one of the people that I loved and cared for went there, and I never told them the truth. That would hurt. Might be why Jesus has to wipe away the tears from our eyes, because, you know, we're afraid we're going to hurt somebody's feelings. You better be afraid that they're going to die and go to hell. There's three garments. If you've got on the one of salvation, you're the best dressed person's ever been. If you're saved today, you know the Lord today is your personal Savior, and you got that raiment of salvation. Woo! Even that, I can't pronounce it, Dior Couture, whatever that is, or the Vanquish II by Dormule. I don't mean anything either. I know what an Amante is. That's cheap stuff. It's only $1,000 for that suit. I don't have any. I get mine at the Unclaimed Baggage, Scottsboro. Amen. I don't care. I want every head bowed and every eye closed. It's time for invitation. I'm going to ask if we could to get our Brother Larry, if you would step over to this side over here and get ready for the to be baptized there. Brother Rick, help him if you would. You're here this morning. Please listen to me carefully. I know we got some visitors here. We got some folks who have been here for a long time. You may be a charter member of this church. You could have been here for the last 35 years. But if you don't have the garment of salvation on this morning, you're in trouble. If you don't have the garment of salvation on, you've got that garment of sin, or you've got that garment of self-righteousness, then you're in trouble this morning. If you're thinking you're going to heaven because you're a Baptist, you're in a pipe dream. If you think you're going to heaven this morning because you've been baptized in a church in Montgomery, Alabama, you're in trouble. If you think you're going to heaven because, listen, my mama was a Baptist, therefore I'm going to heaven. My grandma was a Baptist, therefore I'm going to heaven. If you're here this morning and you think because you're a good person you're going to get there, your righteousness, the Bible says in Isaiah, is like a filthy rag. And listen, God cannot and will not accept that. Sometimes we think I'm going to do a little bit better. You can never get to the better part this morning. All you can ever do is come to the cross this morning. Let me ask you a simple question this morning before she's going to play through softly just a minute, and we'll close this service out and baptize Brother Larry. Well, you're here this morning. I'm going to baptize a man 70 years old. Now, we had 9 children get saved, 1 teenager, 8, 9, 10, 11 years old got saved in a revival. But when this young man here came down the aisle, this old preacher, I was standing back there and I just about wanted to have a spell, because I knew they'd been praying for it. They've been working, and this young man, I'm going to baptize him in just a few minutes, he got saved. And what a blessing that is. But maybe you're here this morning and you'll say, you know, I'm not sure, Pastor. I'm not sure about where, if I was to die right now, where I would go. Now, I'm going to ask you this as plainly as I can. You're here this morning and say, I'm not sure about where if I was to die right now. Would you just put your hand up in the air and say, preacher, pray for me. I'm not sure this morning. I'm just not sure for sure. I don't know that I've ever done those ABCs, as simple as they are. I'm not sure that I've ever asked the Lord to save me, but I want to know today. Just put your hand up and say, preacher, pray for me this morning. Don't be ashamed of this. I want you to go to heaven today. Don't want to make you a member of this church. Don't want to baptize you. Don't even want your money. I want you to walk down the streets of gold with me one day. I mean that. If you're here this morning, you're not saved. Don't leave here today. Say, well, people will talk about me. My dear friend, 1,000 years from now, you'll wish that you had walked an old-fashioned aisle in a little old country church like this one. You wish that you'd have come down here and got on your knees and say, oh, God, save me. Save me, Lord. I don't want to die and go to hell just like Larry did. You're here this morning. If you're here this morning, you say, Pastor, I'm saved. I know that without any doubt whatsoever. If I was to die right now, I can raise my hand because I know. You put your hand up in the air. I know for sure. I know for sure. I know for sure this morning. I know for sure. If you didn't raise your hand, my dear friend, what are you waiting for? What in the world are you waiting for? Amen. Make sure today. Make it sure today. Take care of this today. The devil's favorite day is tomorrow. Just do it tomorrow. Put it off. You're here this morning. She's going to play through softly just a moment and close our service. Brother Cliff, sing one verse of that song. You know it?
Yes,
sing one verse of that song. Listen to this song. One verse. Through softly just a moment more and close our service this morning. I got saved in a revival meeting as a young man, 21 years old. I waited till the very last playing of the piano before I went. But the Lord spoke to my heart that day and said, Jim, this is your last opportunity. You won't get another chance. Lord, speaking to your heart today, respond. Don't put it off. Don't do it tomorrow. Do it today. I will guarantee you, you will never, ever, ever regret it. You'll never regret it. Make sure you don't slip, you know.
He's got his socks like I did.
Yeah.
I told him to hold on.
Yeah, come on. Come on up here, man. Come on right up there. He's worried about getting his hair wet. All right, when you get right there, just be careful right here with them socks on. Just sit down right there. Just sit down and kind of scoot on down there. I don't want you to sit right there. Just sit down right there. Just sit down. Is the water cold?
No.
Okay. All right, come on down. Come on down now. Is it okay?
Yeah,
yeah, it feels pretty good, don't it?
Okay.
Hey, this young man right here, you can sit down if you want to. Can y'all still see him? Good looking man. He's got a good looking haircut, amen. I don't trust people with hair. I'll be honest with you right now. Too much hair worries me. But, you know, back several weeks ago, we, you know, they the guys back here, matter of fact, Rick's on one side and Dennis, the lawyer's on the other. So, and they said, we're going to pray for this young man here. His name's Larry. And all of a sudden, Larry come to church one day, and I mean, I noticed they kept talking to him, and bless goodness, praying for him, and then on our revival meeting, what night was that? Was it Saturday night? Friday night revival service there. I'm back there behind there. I didn't even see him come down. Here he comes. Here comes, I think Billy was there, and Rick was there. Dennis, did you come down too? Dennis was there, and Brother Farr was there. And I saw a man bow his head right there. And no doubt, nobody had to tell you he was a sinner, did he? Mm-hmm. You already knew that. And you know something? He knew that. He believed, though, in all his heart. Over in Acts 16, when the Paul and Silas were in jail, you remember the story. And the jail, they had an earthquake. The jail opened up. All the bars fell off. The gates opened up. The jailer pulled out his sword, was going to kill himself. Because he knew the Romans, he knew they would kill him. And Paul said, hey, do yourself no harm. We're all here. And the next thing that man said was, what must I do to be saved? Yeah. And he said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ with all thy heart, and thou shalt be saved. And they took him that same night, and they baptized him. Can I tell you something else? And his family got saved also. When someone this age gets saved, there's children, as young as I know. Larry's had a tough road, amen? It's been a tough road, and I'm not going to get into that today, but talk to him sometime. It's been a hard road for him. But I'm going to tell you something. God is merciful. Oh, God is merciful. 70 years. I used to think that was old, brother, but I'm catching up with you now. Amen. And I'm pedaling hard towards that 7-0 myself. But you know what? Thank God he still saves old sinners. He'll save the young. He'll save the old. He'll save the middle-aged. This young man has hauled them old trailers up and down the road for how many years?
About 40.
40 years there. Moved a trailer. I'm sure some of y'all probably been involved in that. But, you know, you got some dear friends. You got a sister, a brother-in-law, right? Am I get that right? You got a gal out there at the eating place even come to see you. You got a son named Ricky, right? Got a son named Ricky, huh?
Yes, sir.
He been sitting up there. And you got friends here. And, man, I'm going to tell you something. That's a blessing. This is the greatest thing in the world is when someone walks down. He took off the old sin, the old garment of sin is gone. Jesus, he's still a sinner, but the God sees him as right with him now.
Amen.
And he's got that garment of salvation on, and the devil's going to try his best to convince you you're no good. Go ahead and say, devil, you're right, but I belong to Jesus. Amen. Amen. I belong to him. I want you just to turn around sideways right here, my brother. Now, in a moment, I want you to take that hand and grab your old schnauzer up there, that big old nose you got like mine. I want you to grab that in just a second. And I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost this morning. I praise the Lord for you, man. You don't know how excited I am about you getting saved. He's already running a bus route with Dennis, carrying him over to beautiful Gibbs Village, amen, and breaking him in the right way there. But this morning, I want to baptize my brother now in the name of the God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost today, baptizing him, amen. Baptizing him into death, and raising him unto new life. Amen. 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 You want to say anything?
I appreciate all y'all's help.
Huh?
I appreciate everybody's help and praying for me. Just keep on praying for me. I hope I can do right.
Amen.
Right.
I, I,